Ooh, that sliding was nice. I knew y'all liked that. Hey y'all, what's going on? Thank you for clicking this video and welcome. We got a lot to cover today. In the NBA playoffs, it's in full swing. And when I mean full swing, I mean full swing because a couple of teams are already going home. So I got to catch all up over there and see what's going on inside the bubble. A lot of exciting things happening there. Then I want to talk NHL. They're in a bubble as well and their playoffs is underway as well. And a couple of teams go home as well. They are actually already starting the second round, which is what I'm watching right now on the TV. So if you see me peek over, don't worry about them. Just seeing what's going on between the Tampa Bay Lightning and the Boston Bruins. And then NFL training camp has started. And it has really started. Because for all my athletes out there who have played football, you know that when the pads come on, it's a whole nother ball game. We're separating the men from the boys. We have all of this stuff to cover, so let's jump right into it on the first ever episode of Talking Sports with Sharp. Let's go. All right, y'all, let's hop into the first segment, a segment I like to call, What's the Final? In this segment, I want to talk about the different scores and the different finals around the leagues. Pretty self-explanatory, but we're going to start with the NBA. The first series I want to talk about, though, is the Brooklyn Nets and the Toronto Raptors. Not much to talk about here. To be honest, the Raptors, they swept the Nets today by a score of 150-122. That's rough. It's like 28 point difference right there. And they were just, Toronto was in control of the series the entire time. So I think Toronto looks pretty strong, man. They're the number two seed. And I think they're going to be a problem all through the Eastern Conference. To be totally honest, it seems like everybody's contributing on their team. They're putting up a lot of points, or they did put up a lot of points against the Brooklyn Nets. Granted, the Brooklyn Nets aren't at full strength right now, not having two of their stars, obviously. So in the next series, we're going to stay within the Eastern Conference. This series is not over yet. Miami and Indiana. The Indiana Pacers are trailing 3-0 in this series. The Heat pretty much have had their way. The closest game, I think, was Game 3, where Miami took it 124-115, which is the last game that was played. Miami has an opportunity to sweep this series against the Pacers, a series that I'm kind of surprised about. I thought the Pacers would have a game right now, but unfortunately not. The Heat have some shooters on their team, and I'm telling you, they look pretty strong. The Milwaukee Bucks and the Orlando Magic. The Bucks lead this series 2-1. They took the last game by a final score of 121-107. Bucks pretty strong team, but Orlando did take that first game to make things a little bit interesting. So we'll see how the rest of the series go. Milwaukee responded well. They responded well after losing that first game, which was a shocker to most, if not all. I don't know if many of you had the Orlando Magic even winning any games in this series, but Orlando came out and they played hard, man. In the world of sports, you never know what can happen. So the Bucks do lead that series 2-1 after bouncing back after that game one loss. Staying within the Eastern Conference, Philadelphia 76ers and the Boston Celtics. Listen, the Sixers didn't have anything for Boston in this series. They did it. They just did it. Boston was shooting well. They were playing well. And the Sixers got a taste of Tatum. I'm telling you, Tatum was balling in those first two games. It was unstoppable. But we'll get more into this matchup a little bit later into the show. But the Sixers get swept out of the building by the Boston Celtics 4-0. They lost today 106-110, and Boston is moving on and will face a very strong looking Toronto team. So we're going to see how they do against some better competition. The Sixers just didn't match up well with the Celtics, in my opinion. But we'll get more into that later on to the show. Let's hop over to the Western Conference and see about the matchups over there. Some exciting stuff. Oklahoma City and Houston. The Houston Rockets have the leads in this series 2-1, but OKC took this last game in overtime 119-107. CP3 had a big overtime helping his team get the first win of the series, because falling down 3-0, that's not the way to go in the NBA playoffs. So we'll see how this next game goes between the Houston Rockets and the Oklahoma City Thunder. Now let's look at the next matchup in the Western Conference. A much anticipated matchup that I was looking forward to. Dame and the Trail Blazers versus LeBron and the Lakers. Lakers lead this series 2-1. Portland came out strong in that first game. They took the win 100-93. They lost this last game 116-108 behind a strong game by LeBron James. He picked the team up, put them on his back, took them to the finish line to give the Lakers a 2-1 lead. Moving on to the next matchup in the Western Conference. The Utah Jazz and the Denver Nuggets. This series stands at 2-1. Utah with the lead. Denver took game one, 135-125. But this last game that was played at the time we're recording this, obviously, is 124-87. Utah having their way with the Denver Nuggets. So we're going to see how the rest of this series go. I think this series is a good one that, you know, you guys should keep your eyes on. Teams are matched up very well. And I really like this series. So I'm going to keep my eyes on it. Y'all keep your eyes on it. The last matchup I want to talk about, the Los Angeles Clippers and the Dallas Mavericks. This series right now, 2-2. After today, Luka. Can somebody just say Luka? I heard y'all say it, I think. Listen, Luka went off again, man. I think he had another triple-double today. And the game winner, which might be in our top play. Just keep watching. Stick around. It might be in there. Anyway, this is a good series right here. I like this one. And some may argue that the Mavericks should be up a little bit more in this series. Maybe 3-1. Arguably. We'll see. I think this is a game we might have to take another look into. But right now, this series is tied after Luka hit a dagger today to end the game. Buzzer beater shot. Exciting series right there. And that is all for the NBA playoffs. Now let's hop over to the NHL. All right, y'all. So since the NHL is actually in the second round, I will just give you the winners of the first round and let you know what has taken place thus far in the second round and, you know, game one winners of the second round. First off, we have the Lightning versus the Blues. The Lightning win that series 4-1. Actually, 4-1. Some people thought that series would be a little bit closer, but the Lightning come out on top and they win that series 4-1. The next one is the Capitals versus the Islanders. The Islanders look pretty strong. They won this series against the Caps, who were ranked number 3, 4-1 as well. Took care of the Caps right there. And they move on. Then we have the Bruins and the Hurricanes. The Bruins won their series 4-1. So y'all listen, I just want to say this. 4-1. You see all these 4-1s in the NHL playoffs so far, but it doesn't give you how much excitement there was in those 4-1 series. So that's why I'm telling y'all, man, just hop in on some hockey action and see what's going on. It's very fun stuff. Not hard to learn if you don't watch it, but I love watching it. Go check it out. Some of these games were 2 and 3 overtimes. So I believe one was like 5 overtimes. It was just crazy. So check out the NHL playoffs. But anyway, Bruins win their series 4-1. The Flyers actually take their series 4-2. The Canadiens, a tough young team with a lot of speed over there, gave the Flyers a really good series. The Flyers, they play good, but not great. They have to clean a lot of things up, and they will see what happens in that series. That is the Eastern Conference. Let's hop over to the Western Conference, where the number one Golden Knights took on the Blackhawks. The Golden Knights win their series 4-1. Avalanche 2-7. They win this series. Avalanche does 4-1. The Stars and the Flames 3-6. The Stars win that series 4-2. And then the Canucks 4-5. The Canucks take that series 4-2. So those are all the matchups so far within the NHL playoffs. There have been a couple of games in this second round. Let's take a look at what has taken place thus far. 2 games have been played in round 2. The first one goes to the Lightning and the Bruins. The Bruins, like I said, I just finished watching that game. The Bruins took that game. It got pretty close down the stretch. Boston was up 3-1. And the Lightning got a late goal and tried to put some pressure on even at the very end of the game, but Boston holds them off and takes a one-game lead in that series. The next series, the Avalanche and the Stars lead this series 1-0. They won 5-3 over Colorado, and they take a one-game lead. So that is all for the NHL playoffs at the moment. We will check back in to see. There will be some more games coming up very, very soon because the season is condensed and they got to get the ball rolling so they can get to the Stanley Cup Finals. That'll do it for this edition of What's the Final, and we move right into our next segment. It's called What's Going On? So guys, this segment called What's Going On is a segment where I find stories that make me scratch my head and ask the question, what's going on? So today, safety Earl Thomas was released from the Baltimore Ravens for what they call conduct detrimental. Earl Thomas is a good player, but apparently there's been some drama in Baltimore with him and some of the coaching staff. I don't really know the details of the story, but today he was released. And there's a market for Thomas right now. I'm hearing three teams, or I've read that there were three teams that might be interested or be his next suitors. You have the Dallas Cowboys, the San Francisco 49ers, and I also heard the Texans. And of course, you know, fans want him to come to their teams, but who knows what will happen there. But I just was scratching my head, like, what happened, like, to release a player of that caliber? So we'll have to wait to see how that story unfolds. But for now, Earl Thomas is a free agent, and I honestly would consider signing him to my team if I was any team out there. Next story that I want to talk about is the positive, negative, whatever. They don't know what kind of test results they're getting in the NFL now, but supposedly there are a bunch of negative test results that were once reported positive. How did they find out they were negative? I don't know. But there are a lot of tests that are coming back now negative. What does this mean for the season, though? Like, just let me know in the comment section. What do you guys think that this would mean for the season? Because if something like this happens in the midseason and players are missing games because they were so-called positive from the COVID-19 testing and they miss games, what does that could be detrimental to a season. It could affect the team. What happens then? So hopefully this is something that these guys can get under control and figure out early on. But for now, there were a bunch of tests. I think I saw one number like 77 tests where they were supposedly positive and now they come back negative. So I hope they figure this out, because if football season is going to happen, we need to have it figured out so players won't be missing games. Just a lighter story here. Have you guys seen the Las Vegas Raiders Stadium? I think they practiced in it a couple days ago, if I'm not mistaken. That thing is crazy, and I hope I get to see it in person one day. With COVID going on, not gonna happen. But that stadium looks amazing, and they practiced in it for the first time the other day. So I'm sure they had a good time there. Las Vegas Raiders, just, it's not too catchy. I like Oakland. But anyway, that'll do it for this edition of What's Going On. So guys, this next segment that I want to introduce is called You Make the Call. In this segment is where I think about controversial topics and stories that I want to ask you guys. And I want you guys to get active in the comment section and let me know what you think of this topic. Today, I have one that might hit close to home for some of y'all. So recently in the NFL, there have been some teams thinking about allowing a certain amount of fans in their stadiums. I want to know what you think. Would you go to the games if they allow fans? Well, I've heard some teams say they might allow 10,000 to 20,000. Then some teams say they might allow 14,000. I think the Packers said that they won't allow any until after the first two home games. So I want you to make the call on this one. Would you allow fans back into the stadium at any capacity? Or would you say bring them back at full capacity? Or would you say no fans at all? Let me know in the comment section what you think. You make the call. Okay, y'all, this next segment is going to be one of my favorite segments of the show, and it is Sharp's Top Plays. Let's take a look. obviously these are my top plays, but I would just be picking three of my favorite top plays that I saw during this week or even today in any of the games that I may have saw. First one comes courtesy of CP3. A huge bucket by CP3 in overtime where Oklahoma City is up 110 to 104, but the shot clock is winding down. He adjusts his body, shoots over defender, and knocks down a huge shot in overtime for the Oklahoma City Thunder. By way of the Phillies, Freddie Freeman of the bat slaps one to left field. Roman Quinn hustles over. He throws it where it is cut off by Didi, he throws it home, and Knapp is there to stop a sliding play in to home plate. That would have been the game-tying run. But the Phillies come in at our number two top play of the week. What a play right here, and what a finish to the game. And of course, the number one play for me comes by way of Luka, who was just having a game. He gets the ball in the inbound, crosses over, pull up, three ball in overtime, wins the game. Luka wins the game for his team to tie the series at two apiece with the LA Clippers. What a move right there. Ice in his veins. Shout out to Luka. He was balling, 42 points, and the Mavs tied the series behind that shot. That's going to do it for Sharks Top Plays of the Week. Now it's time for our next segment, what I like to call Going Local. All right, so in this segment here, y'all, really I just focus on the teams that are in my market that are local teams for me. And that would be the Eagles, the Sixers, the Phillies, and the Flyers. First of all, I want to start off with the Flyers. The good news. Listen, the Flyers are moving on to the second round, as I have said earlier. But I also mentioned earlier that in this round, they have to play a little bit better. I mean, the intensity, I think, is going to be up a little bit. And the Islanders did look strong in their series. So I think the Flyers have to clean up on a couple of things. They have to get the power play going. I, off the top of my head, I want to say the power play for the Flyers since being in a bubble was like 2 for 30 or something like that. Don't quote me on that, but it's somewhere in that range, and it just has not been that good. So I think the Flyers getting out of this series with some of their top goal scorers not even scoring is a good sign. Because if they just clean up the things that they were a little bit rusty on in this next series, I mean, this team has a real chance to hoist that cup up. And I'm rooting for them because obviously I'm a Philly guy through and through, and I'm a big Flyers fan. So I hope the Flyers can pull it out this next series. I hope they sharpen a little things up, passing, power play, all those things. And we'll see what'll happen in this next series. But dude, now let's move on to the Sixers. I'll be right back. If y'all can't tell, I'm sweeping. I'm the Celtics. And I'm sweeping the Sixers right out of the playoffs, and that's what happened. The Sixers lose to the Celtics 4-0 in this series, and it's a wrap for them. And I could go on and on the things that I seen wrong in this series. There was no game plan. They were being out-rebounded at times. They were not playing perimeter defense that well either. And the Boston Celtics were really dominating that two-man game where they just set the pick and they come around. And listen, they were shooting well. The Boston Celtics were shooting well. I couldn't understand for the life of me that when the Sixers would get picked, the big man would drop back and not put their hands up, and they're just letting the Celtics shoot, and they were shooting well. The Sixers were just doing a lot of things wrong, and I just don't believe they deserve to be in that series. I called this, them being the sixth seed and probably not making out of the first round. I saw that a long time ago because I saw the areas they were lacking. So they have a lot of big contracts going into the next season. They have to put some guys around these guys and figure out what the issue is. Brett Brown, I could have did this for my You Make the Call segment, but I wanted to switch it up a little bit. Brett Brown's probably out the building, in my opinion. He should be. Now, it does not mean that he's not a good guy or even he's not a good coach. I just don't think that he's the coach for this team. I don't know who the coach is. I don't even know the coaches that might be out there, but right now, it's not Brett Brown. So you go, Sixers go second round exit in 2018, second round exit 2019, and a first round exit in 2020. You're going backwards. Fellas gotta play with some tenacity. The coach has to have a good game plan, and you gotta want it. That's the main thing. And it just did not seem like the Sixers wanted it. And now they are swept right out of the bubble, and they are on their way back to Philadelphia right now as we speak. So, Sixers season over. We'll see what they do in the offseason. In the meantime, let's talk about the Phillies real quick. The Phillies, before today, lost 5 straight games. It's not even a whole lot of science that needs to go into what's going on with the Phillies. Their bullpen, they recently made a trade. They picked up 2 relievers, but their bullpen still struggles. They almost blew this game today. Was it an exciting finish? Yes, but they still almost blew this game. If you want to win in a shortened season, you cannot blow 7-run leads, 6-run leads, however many runs you have leads. They've got a pretty solid lineup, but the bullpen cannot come in and blow games like that. I can't say it enough. They just cannot blow games like that. So the Phillies need to figure out their bullpen situation, and they need to set a fire. Feed off this first game that they got today in an exciting fashion, win over the Braves, and they got to keep the ball rolling because it's a shortened season and every game counts. So now let's look into the Eagles today. They had a light practice, I believe, no pads, but I believe it was a longer practice, but they didn't have any pads on today. The pads did come on a couple weeks ago where they were hitting and tackling to the ground. I don't think there's been any significant injuries. I don't know how accurate the report is, but I did see a report that Andre Dillard, second year man that they just drafted, he supposedly was seen on crutches before camp. I don't really know what's going on there. I don't even know if they know how significant the injury is, but that would be a bigger one if it turns out to be a serious one. And then I also saw third tight end Josh Perkins was also ruled out indefinitely. So those are the two injuries that I did see there. Other than that, I think the Eagles, this is what, 6th practice of camp. So, you know, they're still getting into the flow of things. I think Doug Peterson is trying to urge the team to get that sense of urgency. There is no preseason. Preseason is canceled. So it's right into the regular season. So the preseason, I think, is good for the rookies. And I even think it's good for the vets to just kind of get that game feeling back. But everything is different this year. So preseason probably would not have even felt the same. But I'm hearing that the rookies are looking good. Jalen Hurts is showing off a strong arm. Jalen Reagor doesn't drop many balls. I also heard that. So it's sounding good so far. So not a whole lot out of camp. You have your daily reports. But I'm waiting for the regular season to see how these guys do. Right now, camp is camp. It's just preparing the guys and getting them ready. But right into the season, I'm just wondering how not having preseason might impact some of the rookies. I think the vets will be fine. All right, y'all, we reached the end of the show, but before I end every show, I want to leave you guys with a bit of inspiration, and I want to give you guys a quote. And today's quote will come from Kobe Bryant. May he forever rest in peace. Kobe told us that the most important thing is to try and inspire people so that they can be great in whatever they want to do. Kobe Bryant right there, y'all. Listen, inspire people to be great, and that's what I hope you guys are striving to be. I thank you guys so much for watching this first ever episode of Talking Sports with Sharp. And until next time, guys, always remember, stay sharp. Peace.